Kept my mama up late on her knees as she prayed for her boy who was hanging on by a thread. I was acting a fool, I was skipping on school, getting high as a kite, gonna wind up dead. She believed I'd return like the prodigal, pray to God every day for a miracle. No, I'm not a lost cause, she wouldn't give up on me. And I never would have made it, I never would have made it without you, you, you. And I never would have made it, I never would have made it through without you, you, you. I was coming home late, covering every state in a van with the band, barely getting paid. And the love of my life, she was up through the night with the kids fighting tears, hoping for a break. By my side with the love unconditional, had the faith to believe for a miracle. I know I'm not a lost cause, she wouldn't give up on me. And I never would have made it, I never would have made it without you, you. And I never would have made it, I never would have made it through without you, without you. Tell me where would I be, tell me where would I be without you. If you hadn't been praying for me and standing by me, tell me, oh. Tell me where would I be, tell me where would I be without you. If you hadn't been praying for me and standing by me, I'd be lost without you, without you. What drew and pulled us in. It was not pointed fingers or proving me wrong that called and convicted me to come home. But kindness brought repentance, freedom and forgiveness. Oh, children, if we're gonna be known for something, let it be love, love, love. Speaking the truth means nothing without love, love, love. 'Cause no one's gonna hear us if we keep throwing stones. If we're gonna be known for something, let it be love. The children of God, we painted our signs, saying come as you are, but is that what they find? Ready arms of welcome, steady hands to help them. Rebuild what's been broken, the bridges that burn, for hearts only open with the key trust is earned. How else will they know him? Who else is gonna show them? If we're gonna be known for something, let it be love, love, love. Speaking the truth means nothing
no matter the cost. It is not proud, selfish or rude, lays down its life for its enemies too. It hurts and it cries, bleeds and it dies, hopes and trusts, though it is crushed, believes, sustains, endures the pain.
To the mirror, what do I see? All the imperfections that define me. Thought I was a man, but I'm still a boy. Everything I am, still trying to avoid. I know the golden rule, treat another like you wanna be treated too. But lately I've been hating on myself, it's true. Beat up my heart till it's black and blue. How can I love, can I love, can I love you? If I can't even love myself, I try to hide that I don't. Seem to get harder. I try to hold my tongue, cause it's been getting sharper. I'd open up the gate, but I can't find the key. Maybe I'm afraid, afraid of what you'll see. I know the golden rule, treat another like you wanna be treated to. But lately I've been hating on myself, it's true. Beat up my heart till it's black and blue. How can I love, can I love, can I love you? If I can't even love myself, I try to hide that I don't feel worth. Truth it will always tell. What you carry always shows. What you bury it still grows. How can I love, can I love, can I love you? If I can't even love myself.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Beacon Church. We're so glad that you're here. Why don't you stand? We're going to begin this service by singing God's praise together. Proud of you. You found us this morning in the right location, back here at the Viscardi Center. Our worship services are centered around the person of Jesus Christ. He came for us, that he loves us. Right now, Christ draws us into his presence. We sing in worship and celebration.
The head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore sin and shame, now ruled in majesty. The radiance of perfect love now shines.
is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King.
So we stand here today and we declare his praise together. Throughout this month and this fall, we've been talking about the storms that come upon our families. And we've consistently kind of leaned into that metaphor to say that storms are coming, that we know that there are difficult moments and times and places in this life. If you haven't sensed those storms yet, I know that yours are coming soon. But there's a great truth that Jesus has brought to light in us this fall. It's understanding that it's in the storms that we experience his presence. And it's in the storms that we experience his reign. And so we never ask for the storms to pass us by. But instead we ask that when the storms come, we receive his reign. We receive his nourishment. We receive his power that he has for us. So this morning, know that in whatever storm that you're in, that Jesus has met you there. He's drawing you to himself. And don't miss this opportunity in this storm and in this moment to hear God speaking to you, to know that his Spirit is dwelling in you.
Thunder with a new future to tell, for the dry season is over, there is a cloud beginning to swell. To the skies heavy with blessing, lift your eyes, offer your heart. Jesus Christ, open the heavens. Now we receive the Spirit of God. We receive your seed buried in sorrow, you will call forth in its time. You are Lord, Lord of the harvest, calling our hope now to rise. You know this now, we receive your promise to come. Everything that you have spoken will come to pass. So let it be
to you in these times of difficulty and of frustration, of pain. And we know that it's in those moments that you've met us. And we don't simply know in an abstract way because it's promised in your scripture, although that's true. But we also know from the experience of our own lives, because we can look back and we can see that there have been times and places and moments and seasons that you have met us. And in real time, we may not always understand what you're doing and how you're doing it. But then later, with the perspective of looking back, we see how you have met us. We see where you have met us. So our prayer this morning, God, is that we would see your faithfulness again. That in the storms of life that strike families, that we would look back and say, as you were once, so be it again. So we look to you today for that source of hope and strength and love and power, because we know that you've done it before.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
So we worship you, the God who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ever ask or could imagine. To you is all glory and power, both in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, those to come before and those to follow. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're so glad you're here. Why don't you turn and say hello to everyone there around you. Introduce yourself. Be friendly. Then be seated sometime later. Well, it is our privilege to welcome you here to the Viscardi Center for the Worship Services of Beacon Church. It's especially our privilege to welcome you if you are a guest here today. We have guests at Beacon each and every week, and so if this is your first time here, we welcome you. We're so glad to have you, and we would love to get to know you and to meet you. And in fact, the best thing you can do is make sure to stop by our Welcome Center. Guests, we have a gift there for you that you don't want to miss out on. There's definitely something delicious in the bag, plus an opportunity just to learn a little bit more about the church. Plus, if anyone here has any questions about the facility or how to check in your kids or how to plug into small groups or how to join a ministry, all of that is right there at the Welcome Center. So you can go and connect with them at any time. They're here to serve each and every week. Now, for everyone who's here today, whether it's your first time or you come every single week, we would love to receive a connection card from you, either paper or digital. This is the best way that we can stay in touch as a church, to know how everyone is doing, to know how we can be praying for each other, also how we can be equipping each other for next steps in your faith. You know, church is not an event that you come to on a Sunday. Church is a family where we come together and we serve together and we grow together. And so we would love to just connect with you through the connection card to equip you in any of those steps that you are ready for here today. This is also a time in our service when we receive financial gifts, tithes, and offerings. If you're a guest today, please don't feel compelled in any way to give money. This is a time for those who call Beacon Church their home to come together and support all the great ministry that's happening here each and every week. And you can see there are three ways to give, one of which is the envelopes that the ushers will be collecting. And the ushers are going to come in just a minute. And if you're saying, wait, this is moving too quick for me, I'm not ready, no problem. There's always a box in the back. It's right there by Scott. I don't know if you know Scott. Ruggedly handsome guy standing right there next to the box. The other handsome, that one. Okay, by the box. You can always go see him at any time, turn in connection cards and offering and all of that. So, ushers, why don't you go ahead and come? So, today we have several things to celebrate. First, we want to let you know, yesterday, a team of our runners went into Brooklyn and ran a half marathon with Team World Vision. You'll notice the runners, they're all the ones who are kind of the walking dead today. There's not a lot happening with the knees and the ankles, but they'll be back soon. We're really proud. Our runners did a great job. We had a number of first-time runners. We had some return runners as well. But listen, they don't run simply for fitness. We run because we're passionate about clean water projects. It's something here at Beacon that we've worked on together for over 8 years, because there are thousands of children who die every year through preventable causes, through drinking dirty water. In fact, in the developing world, 6 kilometers is the average distance that women and children go to retrieve dirty water for their families. And as you would expect, 6 kilometers is almost 4 miles. To walk 4 miles with heavy water takes a long time. So it pulls women and children out of opportunities for education, pulls them out of opportunities to go into business. And instead, their job is to get water all day and all year and for a lifetime. And so when we come together, each person who gives $50, that money is aggregated, and you can change the life of one person forever. And I've been to Africa. I've seen the sites where World Vision is at work, and it's amazing. I went last year. I saw one of the new wells that existed, and it was on the edge of the property of the school. And the school is now overrun with kids. They said, you know, 5 years ago, this school was almost empty. Now it is so full that World Vision built another building for them, all because the kids don't miss school anymore. Because something that's consistent across the whole world is when you have stomach trouble, you don't go to school because you don't want to be embarrassed. And when that's taken away, when the children drink clean water, they go to school every day. Lives start to change. So it is not too late. You can still text our regular number, text the word water to our texting number, or go to our website and support the team. So if you want to jump on there, especially as you kind of see them hobbling around today, you can laugh at their expense. We don't mind. And then just donate to the team would be fantastic. All right. Also want to let you know, next week is our crew expo, the opportunity that you have to learn more about many of the ministries that you're probably thinking about serving in. I know, because I look at the data, that about half of you have yet to plug into a ministry. So next week would be an opportunity to say, you know, I've always been interested in knowing what it's like to take down pipe and drape with Ted. Or I've always wanted to know what it's like to set up sound with Billy. Well, people like that are going to be here, so you can talk to them. Say, hey, what is it really like? Do they really make you get here at 6 a.m.? And you say, no, we have the privilege to get here at 6 a.m. Like, oh, okay, I see. And so it's a great chance. So don't miss it. Next week is the Ministry Expo, so don't miss out. So we're going to turn ourselves now to a time of prayer, as we often do. And today, our theme for prayer is celebration. because you may realize today is your 1 year anniversary. Happy anniversary to all of you. This is our 1 year of being in this space. We've been meeting now at the Viscardi Center for 1 year, and it's been a great year. And so we're going to pray a prayer of celebration and then also a prayer of asking God to do even more in us, through Beacon, and throughout Long Island. So let's take some time now for prayer. God, we focus our hearts and our minds solely and completely on you right now. In this moment, God, we're honored to celebrate the faithfulness that you've shown us this past year as we've met here for worship at the Viscardi Center. God, I can remember how going back a year and a half or 2 years or even 3 years, we were praying saying, God, we feel like our space is holding back your mission, and how can we pursue your mission more fully, God? Could you give us more space? And you revealed this path into the Viscardi Center that we never expected, and it's been one of the best years in the history of our church. And so, God, we celebrate what you have done in this room, but even more importantly, in the hearts of your people, only using rooms and space as a tool for the actual mission of God. And so we're humbled to be reminded over and over how you're watching over us, God. Just, even just one small church in one county, in one place, God, that we said we need something from you, God, that you met it. And as you are so prone to do, you met our need in a way we didn't expect, which turned out even better than we could have imagined. So we celebrate that you have done that here with us. And God, we stand on the platform of that celebration to now boldly go before you with confidence to say, God, we're asking you to do even more. Because we know that just within a short drive and even walk of this room, there are thousands and tens and even hundreds of thousands of people who do not yet know and worship and serve Jesus. We know that their lives are full of brokenness. Their hearts are broken and they don't know where to turn. We know that they're distracted by the trappings of life, by the activities that are overwhelm us, by the responsibilities that we seek out and then crush us. And so, God, I pray that you would use Beacon as the metaphor of light that we've always embraced, that it would radiate out from this place on this corner, but throughout our entire county, that there would be none remain who do not have the opportunity to learn about the person of Christ. There would not be one man, there would not be one woman, there would not be one child who has not had repeated opportunities to embrace the good news of Jesus. God, forgive us for the times when we fall short in pursuing the mission that you've laid on our hearts. We know that there are times that your Spirit has gone before us and has prepared opportunities in advance for us to do your will. And when that chance comes, sometimes we miss it. So God, would you teach our hearts to be more sensitive? Would you teach our hearts to be more aware of how you're acting and how you're working so that when we have those moments, we step into that gap and we demonstrate Christ to all who surround us. God, I also lift up to you in prayer every church in Nassau County that is coming together to teach and preach the name of Jesus. I pray for the Revive LI coalition of churches that you've made us a part of, God. There are so many churches. I think of all of our friends today who are pastoring in their own places and on their own corners and in their own buildings, God. I think of Dan and Steve and John and Brian and Henry and the other Dan and so many other pastors, God. I pray that you would be giving them the articulation of the Holy Spirit that comes through you so that all of us can be one spiritual family. That in the way that a rising tide floats every ship, that your Spirit would be working, that every church that preaches and teaches the name of Jesus would see guests come, would see life, would see growth, would see an increase in the fulfillment of your mission that you've laid on our hearts. God, I pray that any way that our church can come alongside of any other church, I pray that you show that to us, and we will continue to do that, that we will continue to be a part of the sister and brotherhood of Christ that you've drawn us into. And God, as we as a church now turn to the study of your scripture, I pray that as Trevor unpacks your word, we will see how you have been with our families from the beginning, how you even created us to need each other in ways that reflect you that we're still understanding and learning. So God, find our hearts to be eager, our ears to be receptive, and our minds to be open. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky. Stormy weather.
So there's an ingredient, often unspoken ingredient, that shows up in all of our relationships. And in some relationships, it's kind of front and center. In other relationships, it's a little more off to the side. But this ingredient is present in all of our relationships. It's present when you relate to your mom or your dad or your brother or sister or your son or your daughter or your niece or your nephew or your husband or your wife. And this ingredient is actually, it's so present that it even shapes the way that we talk about these relationships. And this ingredient is gender. Gender. It shows up in all of our relationships. Some relationships, the fact that gender is involved in the relationship is the source of some of the joy in that relationship. In other relationships, the fact that gender is present in that relationship is why there's frustration in that relationship. But gender is present. It's an ingredient in all of our relationships. And if relationships are like cocktails, gender is kind of like the alcohol content, right? Because not all cocktails have the same alcohol content. Some have more, some have less. And not all cocktails can you tell what the alcohol content is just kind of by tasting it, right? And I know this has never happened to any of you, all right? But if you start throwing back cocktails and you're not aware of the alcohol content in those cocktails, you will quickly start doing things you regret, and the situation will get messy fast, right? I know none of you have ever experienced that, right? Because you're good Christians. But with relationships, gender is always present in our relationships, and it plays a different role in different relationships, and it's more powerful in some relationships than other relationships. But if we're ignorant to it and we're not aware of the impact that gender is playing in our family relationships, it can cause serious problems. It can actually create storms in our relationships, and when storms come into our relationships, rather than being able to weather them, it can cause more frustration and struggle. And we're in this series called Storm-Tossed Family, and it is it's not based on a book, it's inspired by a book. Like, you know the difference between like a movie that's based on a book that actually sounds like the book and a movie that's inspired by the book. So it takes some general themes and characters. This series is inspired by the book Storm-Tossed Families. And as I was reading through this book and prepping for this series with Chris and Robert, there's one chapter in there that really gripped me, and it was called Man and Woman at the Cross. And in this chapter, he spoke about gender in a way, in a balanced way, that forced me to reconsider and rethink about what the Bible actually teaches about gender, and equally important, what the Bible doesn't say about gender. And so today, we're going to actually take some time to have a conversation that I don't know if it happens very often in churches. We're going to talk about gender, because of course it is a hot button issue in society today. And I'm happy to announce, I'm not even going to touch on the whole transgender thing. Not because I don't think it's an important topic, but statistics show that this is something that affects 0.01% of the population, which means if this is something that happens to affect you, we can create enough time to have a personal conversation with all 0.01% of people that are wrestling with some of these things. And this is something that requires a personal conversation. And so we're not really going to address that. But there's a lot of other conflicts that happen around gender that are in the news constantly. You know, there's the question of like toxic masculinity, right? Is toxic masculinity a thing, or is it just, you know, society trying to domesticate men? Or there's, you know, different variations on feminism, and what is the Christian response to some of these conversations? And there's the Me Too movement, which is in general a very gender-rich issue, right? Because it's mostly men who are assaulting mostly women. And so gender is present in all of these things in kind of the media, but it's also present in our interpersonal relationships right at home. It's present in how you relate to your wife and how you raise your children. And so this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to go all the way back to the beginning, and we're going to look at what the Bible actually teaches about gender, where it started, why it started, and what it's comprised of. And so if you have a Bible, I'd love for you to open up to Genesis chapter 2, beginning in verse 18. All right? We're going to be looking at the origin of humanity and where gender first comes on the scene in the Bible. And just a couple of ground rules as we go into it, things to keep in the back of your mind. What's really cool is there's a lot of things about our society, about like Western American culture, that was shaped by Christianity and biblical ethics, which means there are a lot of things that feel very natural to us that actually line up with the Bible. So we're going to read things in Scripture, and you're going to be like, yes, that sounds right, that feels right. At the same time, for all of us, there are times, including myself, there are times we're going to read things in Scripture that contradict our own personal presuppositions and beliefs. And if God is real and he exists outside of us, then we should expect that he's going to at times contradict us and even confuse us, right? And so we don't run from those things. We embrace the fact that I'm not God, and I, you know, it would be kind of amazing if me and God had the same idea about everything, right? So we acknowledge that sometimes Scripture is going to contradict us, and we submit to God. And then there's a third category, and there are a lot of beliefs and presuppositions that you might have come in here today with that Scripture doesn't affirm, but it also doesn't, you know, contradict. Right? There are things that Scripture doesn't necessarily say explicitly or implicitly, but they're your beliefs and opinions about certain things, and they might be right, they might be wrong. This is what the Apostle Paul calls disputable issues, and he gives really, really sound advice for what to do with disputable issues in Romans 14. He says, so whatever you believe about these things, that is disputable issues, keep between yourself and God. There you go. So when it comes to this conversation about gender, we look at what the Bible says. I encourage you to delight in the ways that you already agree with what God has to say. Learn to bow your hearts to what God says that might contradict what you have to say. And things that he doesn't say or doesn't comment on, just keep it to yourself. All right. So Genesis chapter 2, beginning in verse 18. This is the very beginning after God created Adam. It says, the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Say suitable helper. Suitable helper. All right. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky, and he brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that is what its name was. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no what? No suitable helper was found. And right away, we see the why of Eve. Why did God create Eve? Because God said it's not good for Adam to be alone, and he wanted to find a suitable helper. But we need to kind of define terms a little bit, because I don't know if you know this, the Bible wasn't written in English. It was written in Hebrew. And so this first word, suitable, that's translated suitable, it actually means equal and adequate. All right? So when it talks about a suitable helper, it's talking about an equal and adequate companion for Adam. Somebody who is equal in stature, but also adequate for the job that Adam was assigned. And we see this in Genesis 1. When it talks about God creating Adam and Eve, it says, God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them, right? They're on the same plane here, both created in his image. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it, all right? So the command, the mission is be fruitful and multiply, all right? Is this something Adam could have done on his own? No, he needed a suitable helper, somebody who was adequate for the job. And so here we see that Eve is, she's adequate for the task at hand, and she's equal to him. Then there's this word, helper. And it comes from the Hebrew word, azer. All right, everybody say azer. Azer. So this Hebrew word, azer, is translated helper. And our English word helper, it can mean a lot of different things. For instance, Robert's my boss, right? And so every so often, Robert will be working on something, and he will call me in, he will ask for my help in whatever task he's doing. And so I will provide assistance. I will be a helper to him, and that help is kind of coming from below up, right? But there's other times where I'm working on something and I run into an issue and I call on Robert to help me do whatever it is I'm trying to accomplish. And in that situation, it's still help, right? He's still my helper, but it's coming from the top down. And we have to understand that when we read helper, a lot of times we read into this word our kind of English idea of like personal assistant or assistant to the regional manager, or, you know, we read helper and we think secretary. All right, but this Hebrew word, it shows up twice here in Genesis. It only shows up three other times in the Old Testament, all right? And all three times, it refers to God as our helper, all right? So is this a help that's coming from below up, or is this a help coming from the top coming down? And what's important about these three other instances is in Exodus and Deuteronomy, both of those books were also written by Moses. So Moses, who wrote this Genesis account, is also writing these two other books. So it's the same author. He uses this word four times, two to refer to Eve, two to refer to God, right? And then this third one is really interesting because it shows up in Hosea. And if you're familiar with the story of Hosea at all, the dominant picture in Hosea is this beautiful picture of God as the husband and Israel as the bride. And it's this, if you've never read it, it's amazing. But God is the husband, Israel is the bride. But then here it says, you are destroyed, Israel, because you are against me, against your helper. So God, who like takes on the role of the groom, of the husband, is calling himself the helper of his bride, right? And so when we read this idea of suitable helper, all right, it's a mistake to kind of read into it our English ideas of a personal assistant or a secretary, all right? This is an equal and adequate person who's coming in to help with a task. And as much as that Eve is helping Adam accomplish his mission, Adam is going to help Eve accomplish her mission. They're both required, and it's an equal playing field. And so if helper for you, if that word helper is in any way like distracting and you just can't get past it, go in your Bible and just cross out and write azer, because azer is the actual word that was in there, and then you could define it as what it actually is, right? So Adam and Eve, they're equal from the beginning, and this is affirmed through the redemption that comes at the cross, right? There's neither Jew or Gentile, slave or free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ. So in Christ, all right, in Christ, any like hierarchical value statements are eliminated between men and women, right? Even if they exist in society, they don't exist in God's economy. Furthermore, Adam and Eve and men and women, we are equal in our glory. In 1 Peter, it says, husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life. Which means men and women are both heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Which means in all right, so men, even if you're like the manliest man in the room, however you want to define that, all right, if you came across the frailest of women in her glorified state, you would fall on your face and cower in fear. Right? Because men and women alike are co-heirs with Christ, and in our glorified state, we're going to judge angels, all right? So keep this in mind when we have to keep this in mind when we talk about gender and men and women in light of the cross. It's why Russell Moore says, if we do not start with the truth of a common humanity in the creation and in the crucifixion, we end up deifying gender distinctions in ways that harm one another and lead us to worship a different God. And so we have to start here. Men and women, we're on equal playing field here, right? In God's economy, we are of equal value, equal stature, right? And in this way, when it comes to like ideas of feminism, all right? When feminine, and there's a lot of varieties of feminism, but any expression of feminism that is fighting for women to be treated equal is a good thing. Christians should get behind that. Anything, if we ever see injustice that tries to reduce women or treat them as something less than men, we should stand against that, because that is ungodly and is unbiblical, right? But we continue on here in Genesis 2. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. And the man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman," right? Not another man. "She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." And you see that when God created woman, he created something distinct. He took Adam, who was male, and he created another who was female. And I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but what was the problem that God originally said? Right? He says it's not good for man to be alone. So why didn't he just create another Adam? Like, it totally is in his wheelhouse that he could have just made a duplicate of Adam, and all of the Adams in the world could be able to just, you know, spontaneously regenerate other atoms. Like, he could have done it that way, but he chose not to. And it's not accidental. It's not something just like God decided in this one instance. Actually, we have to understand that this story about the creation of Adam and Eve happens at the very end of the creation narrative, all right? So chapters 1 and 2, it tells this whole story of creation. And if you, when you get to the end of the story, you turn the page, and it's a whole new story. It's about the fall of humanity, so it's on to something else. But this, the creation of Adam and Eve, it is the crown of creation. And we have to understand their creation in light of all of creation. All right, so the very first sentence in the Bible, "In the beginning, God created..." I think we could do better than that. "In the beginning, God created..." The heavens and the earth, right? So God, from the very beginning, he takes two distinct, he creates two distinct but interrelating realms, heaven and earth. And then it says God said, let there be light. And the next thing it says is that God separated the light, right? He separated the light from the darkness, and he created two distinct, right? Two distinct but interrelated essences, light and darkness. And the very next thing it says that God did is that he separated the waters from above from the waters below. And he created the atmosphere and the terrestrial earth. And he separated, he created these two distinct entities that are interrelated to one another. And the very next thing he does is says that God separated the waters and he created dry land. And that he took these two distinct realms, right? Land and sea. But he created them in such a way that they interrelate to one another. And finally, all right, you see the pattern, right? He's taking these two distinct entities that relate together. And then he gets to Adam, and he's alone. And he says, no, this isn't my plan. See, my plan from the beginning is to create these two distinct identities that are going to be interrelated and interwork with one another. And he creates Eve as a distinct being. And this wasn't an accident. This is central to the creation narrative, right? This means, as Tim and Kathy Keller say, this means that our maleness and our femaleness is not incidental to our humanness, but it constitutes its very essence. God doesn't make us into a generic humanity and then later differentiated. Rather, from the start, we are male and we are female. And, you know, modern science has confirmed this for us, because it's only been in the last 100 years that we started to realize that our maleness and our femaleness, it goes deeper than just our genitals, that it actually goes onto every single cell in your body is stamped with either the double X chromosome or an XY chromosome. Like, every cell in your body is stamped with your biological gender. Right, that you are either a male or a female. And as followers of Christ, we have to acknowledge that God created this distinction intentionally. It wasn't an accident. It wasn't an afterthought. It's at the very core of how he created the whole of the universe, right? Creating these two distinct entities that interrelate to one another. But there's a couple of errors that I think we can easily fall into when we start to talk about the distinction in gender. Because, right, from the very beginning, God is creating these two different entities, right? Male and female, light and dark, heaven and earth, sea and land, atmosphere and the earth below. And these are two interlocking, interrelated, but different, distinct entities, right? This is how God created from the very beginning. But we can have a tendency, if we're not careful, especially in society, to fall in one of two errors. And the first error is that we try to flatten out the distinctions, right? And we start to say, well, men and women aren't just equal. Men and women are essentially the same, right? And we start to flatten out the distinctions, the things that make men men and the things that make women women. And we start to say, no, they're all essentially the same. But the problem is, if we're exactly the same, that harmony is broken, right? There's nothing that allows us to cling to one another. And we can do this in a variety of ways. This is kind of going back to feminism. There's also varieties of feminism that really push this. Instead of just saying that women are equal, they say women are the same as men, and they're interchangeable with men, right? And as soon as you do that, we kind of flatten out the distinction. We say that men and women are essentially just the same thing. And the problem with that is, one, there's no longer any sort of, like, reasonable connection, right? It just starts to fall apart. Not only that, if you think about it, if men and women are kind of interchangeable, I already have one. Why do I need the other one? Right? And when we flatten out those distinctions, all of a sudden, instead of realizing that both man and women are essential to God's will and design for creation, we can start to say that men and women are interchangeable, and therefore man or woman is dispensable rather than essential. And, you know, this shows up in a variety of ways, right? It can show up in kind of the feminist movement in some ways, but it can also show up in our homes, all right? And this is where it gets super practical, right? Because there are times where, you know, if you're married, there are times where you want your spouse to act more like you and take on some of your gender distinctions, right? Like, I know, ladies, I know, and these are, I'm going to throw out some stereotypes. Forgive me, they are stereotypes. I know they don't apply to everybody. But just for the sake of example, ladies, when your husband comes home from work and you ask how his day was, and he doesn't give you the full rundown of every little thing that he did that day and what he ate for lunch and how his sandwich was different than it was the day before, but it was like the same as it was last Tuesday, but it wasn't as good as it was that one time when he had lunch with John and they got to talk about the vacation. And when he comes home from work and you ask, how was your day today? And he says, it was fine, and says nothing more, all right? That might be frustrating, but at the same time, don't try to, like, pressure him to be you, all right? It's okay that you're not the same. We need to embrace these differences and acknowledge them. And, you know, it might be different in your relationship how this shows up, but, you know, don't get upset if your husband doesn't process emotion in the same way that you do, or that he, you know, he pushes past things and doesn't, you know, get affected by things in the same ways that you do. We don't want our spouses to be exactly like us. And husbands, all right? Husbands, if your wife, all right, and again, I know this is like relying on stereotypes, but if your wife doesn't have the same sex drive as you and doesn't get turned on by the same things as you, which is everything and anything, don't get frustrated by that and be like, why aren't you more like me? Like, don't try to make your wife's sexuality more like your own. She has her own distinct sexuality. And again, this is going to show up in a variety of different ways in different relationships. And there, and we're going to get to this in just a moment, but there isn't necessarily one way that it's going to, you know, your masculinity or femininity is going to show up every time and that it's, you know, uniform to all people. But what we're doing in those instances when we try to, you know, force our spouse to be more like us is we're actually taking those gender distinctions and we're doing the very same thing. And we're saying, I actually want you to be more like me. And you're flattening out those distinctions. And now those distinctions are the things that actually hold us together, right? But there's another error that we can fall into, and that's that we can over-define these distinctions, right? And we could start to come up with a whole list of, you know, what goes into a real man and what defines a real woman. And I really looked through Scripture this week. And do you know what? You know what Scripture, how like Scripture defines a real man, how Scripture defines a real woman? Do you know what it boils down to? Biology. And there's nothing more. There's actually nothing explicitly more in Scripture that like really kind of spells out this is what manhood looks like and this is what womanhood looks like. And I don't think that's an accident, but just, you know, for the sake of trying to put something together for you guys, I threw this together. I took a bunch of biblical principles and kind of threw them together. How does this sound for a godly man? His wife has full confidence in him, and because of him, she lacks nothing of value. He brings her good, not harm, all the days of his life. He works with eager hands. He brings food from afar. He gets up while it's still night to provide for his family and his employees. He considers an investment and buys it. And out of his earnings, he does something fruitful, right? He sets about his work vigorously. His arms are strong for his tasks. He sees that his trading is profitable, and he burns the midnight oil. He opens his arms to the poor and extends his hands to the needy. And when storms come, he has no fear for his household because all of them are covered. He's well-dressed, and his wife is respected in the community. He develops products and sells them and supplies people with goods. He's clothed with strength and dignity, and he can even laugh at the days to come. He speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on his tongue. He watches over the affairs of his household and avoids idleness. His children look up to him, and his wife respects him. Above all, he fears the Lord. Does that sound like a pretty good definition of a godly man? Some of you might have already picked up on this. This is actually, I just changed the pronouns. This is Proverbs 31 describing a godly woman, right? It sounds like a great definition of a godly man, and this is actually the Bible describing a godly woman. And where are my type A people in the room? You know who you are, right? Yeah, you're type A people. I have bad news for you. The Bible doesn't give us a nice, neat picture of what the biblical picture of manhood or the biblical picture of womanhood, because there's not a picture of manhood and a picture of womanhood. And we have to be careful that we don't try to add to the, you know, the base definition of what it is to be a man and what it is to be a woman with our own cultural, our own culture's ideas of this. In fact, in Scripture, when it does kind of say things that are, you know, gives direct commands to men and women, usually those commands are actually addressing how the culture, right, the culture around has, like, somehow shaped what manhood or womanhood looks like, and Scripture is saying, no, 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 that's not what it looks like. So it's not necessarily saying defining what manhood looks like, it's saying what it's not, right? And so 1 Peter, when he says to women, I know, you know, fortunately we've progressed past this, but in the first century, apparently women in that time, they would find their, like, worth and value in their physical beauty. I know, it's shocking. So glad we've moved past this. But they would find their worth and value in their physical beauty, and they would adorn themselves with all this stuff, and he charges them, and he says, hey, women, don't find your beauty in this. Work on this inner beauty. That's not to say that men should do that, or like men don't struggle with vanity, but obviously this was something that was more targeted to women in the day. And on the converse, he says to men, be considerate and respectful to your wives. In a world where patriarchy was rampant and men could just trample over their wives, he steps in and he says, that's not what masculinity and manhood looks like. And it's not to say that women shouldn't be considerate and respectful to their husbands, but he's addressing some of the ways that society in that day has twisted and distorted manhood and womanhood. And we need to be extremely cautious that we don't let culture's definition of manhood and womanhood come into our definition and add all of these things that Scripture doesn't add. You know, like in society, in some strains of society, like manhood is seen as kind of this rugged, self-confident aggression, right? And anything that tries to, like, you know, thwart that or tame that is seen as trying to neuter men, right? You've kind of heard some of this in the discourse in the last year or so. And yet, self-confident aggression is never, never accepted by God. Actually, if you read through the godly men in Scripture, wherever that self-conscious or self-confident aggression shows up, God, like, nips it in the bud real fast, right? You see Lamech and his boasting. This is Cain's like great-grandson. He's boasting of, you know, his triumphs. And this was actually the picture of human depravity, right? You see Moses. Moses, prince of Egypt. He has all this confidence. He sees injustice, and he aggressively comes in. He beats an Egyptian to death, and then God benches him for 40 years until Moses is a shell of himself and confident to do nothing. Right? Gideon, he's hiding out in a wine cellar, like scared to death of the invading armies. And an angel shows up to him and says, "Mighty warrior." And it's like, who? It's a joke, right? He's not a mighty warrior. But God, who is the mighty warrior, uses Gideon to win these great battles, which is amazing. But then Gideon lets it go to his head, and he becomes this self-confident aggressor. And that's when everything goes downhill in Gideon's life. God has no room for self-confident aggression, right? At the same time, there's this other strain in our society that say men are just kind of these apathetic, passive, emotionally inept buffoons just waiting for a woman to come in and, you know, sophisticate them and everything. But that also isn't a biblical picture of manhood. And so we need to be conscious of how manhood is defined and womanhood is defined in our society. Because what happens is if we start to add all of these things that aren't in the Bible, it does a couple of things. One, all of a sudden you start to see why men and women are clashing so much. Because we have such a narrow picture of manhood and womanhood that isn't shaped by scripture, but it's shaped by our own cultural sensibilities. But even further, all right, and this I think is really important, especially for parents to take into consideration. We create such a narrow picture of what these look like, that manhood and womanhood looks so much like this, that only a few people actually fit this mold. And we take things that are cultural preferences and we say, no, this is what it means to be a man. But what happens when you tell your son that, you know, boys like blue, and they play sports, and they don't like pink, and they, you know, they don't go into fashion or musical theater. Like, but at the same time, that's what he really likes. And those things aren't masculine or feminine. Like, you guys understand that. Like, we culturally kind of made some of these decisions. 100 years ago, pink was a boy's color, right? But when we say to our children that, well, these desires in your heart, which have nothing to do with sexuality, right? These desires in your heart, they don't line up with my picture of manhood. What do you think that does to the kid? Do you think he's like, oh, I'm going to stop desiring to do these things that I really like? Or is he going to question whether or not he's a man? But God has one definition of manhood and womanhood, and it's mostly below the belt, right? It's not about tastes and dispositions. And so we need to be really cautious in our defining what manhood and womanhood looks like in light of scripture and not some of the cultural trends of the day. Because these cultural trends, they keep changing and evolving. And what was manly for your grandparents is not manly for your grandchildren, all right? We need to understand that some of these things change over time. And if scripture doesn't say it, we shouldn't cling to these things so tightly. Because in the end, what we're doing is we're creating this clash when all along God's purpose in the distinction was to create harmony, right? Two distinct beings that interrelate, creating harmony. From the very beginning and all the way to the end, this was God's plan, harmony. And you know, harmony, it requires distinction. It's not two people singing the melody, right? You need somebody singing the other line. There needs to be distinction. We need to recognize that men and women aren't the same. We can't flatten that out, but we can't over-define it either. And we need to embrace the other. Not trying to make our spouse more like us. Not trying to force our kids into some culturally defined mold. But understanding that there are differences and distinctions in embracing the other. Pursuing this harmony. Because at the very beginning, all right, at the very beginning, the creation story, it starts with God saying, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the creation story ends with a marriage. All right, look at what it says. That is why a man, in verse 24, that is why a man leaves his father and mother and he's united to his wife and they become one flesh. And Adam and his wife were both naked and they felt no shame. This is the culmination of the creation story. God creates these two distinct beings to be united in harmony. All right? Creation starts with the creation of heaven and earth as distinct entities. ends with a marriage between these two distinct beings. But you jump to the end of Scripture, all right? You jump to the end of Scripture, and the end, you go all the way to Revelation, and it starts with a wedding, all right? And it's not a wedding between a man and a woman. It's a wedding between Christ and his bride, the church. And then the next thing that happens, it says that there was a new heaven and a new earth, and that new heaven was actually coming down to earth. And heaven and earth are being united in harmony, so much so that, God's realm and our realm become the same realm, all right? And this is what our maleness and femaleness is picturing from the very beginning. It's picturing this union of heaven and earth. It's our hope. And when men and women, not just a man and a woman, but when mankind and womankind in our distinctions find ways to live in harmony, to affirm one another and encourage one another and accommodate one another and build each other up in unity, that we are actually picturing, all right, we're picturing that unity of heaven and earth that has been God's plan from the very beginning. And so I encourage you, wherever you're at in your relationships, whether you're married, single, to find ways of embracing the other, to reaching across the aisle, to affirm the distinctions between men and women, and to encourage those distinctions, but to love each other through those distinctions. Not trying to flatten them out, not trying to over-communicate, not trying to over-define them, but building each other up in harmony. Let's pray. Father, we are sometimes just confused by some of the decisions that you make. And when we only get to see part of the picture, some of that confusion, it sinks in deeper and deeper. And God, adding to the confusion, we have just the society around us whispering things in our ears and communicating things to us that sometimes cause us to think certain things are natural and unnatural. And God, I pray that your word will stand apart from our personal preferences, from our cultural sensibilities, and that we'd come to see and understand that the beauty of manhood and womanhood, the beauty of mankind and womankind living in harmony with one another. God, and we pray that you will, in each of us, give us a desire to understand how you shaped us, and every man in this room, how you've shaped him into a man, how every woman in this room, how you shaped her into a woman, how they could take their maleness and their femaleness and bring it in to a unity that is beautiful, a unity that reflects the hope that we have of one day, heaven and earth, being united in perfect harmony forever. We ask this in Jesus' name.
We have the privilege of coming to the table of communion now. And as we do, we like to give us all an opportunity to examine our hearts, to take just a few moments and to put our heart before God and say, Lord, what is here that I need to repent of? And maybe you've been listening here and you know that you've been playing to different types of stereotypes, or you've been wrestling with things yourself that you know aren't honoring God. And we're going to take just a few minutes to be able to let those go now in an act of confession. So take a few quiet moments and settle your hearts before him and confess what he brings to your mind. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Amen. the night that Jesus was betrayed and given over to suffer and die. He took the bread, given thanks for it, blessed it. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth the true bread from heaven. We break this bread and we participate in the body of Christ that was given for us. In a similar way, after the supper, he took the wine. After he'd given thanks, he blessed it. This is the blood of the new covenant. It's the blood of Christ that was shed so that we could have the forgiveness of sins. This time I'm going to invite you to stand. And as you stand, it's helpful to remember that at Beacon, our focus is on the work that Jesus Christ did on the cross. So you don't have to be a member here or even a regular attender. If you are pursuing a relationship with Jesus, then we encourage you to participate with us here at the Lord's table. And so come up row by row and participate with us as the band leads us in worship.
World will fade, the treasures of our God remain. Here I empty myself to all this world, nothing, and find everything in you. The riches of this world. Treasures of our God remain. Here
and continue standing and recite this communion response with me. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that we may declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his wonderful light. What shall we say in response to these things?
Thank you so much for coming this morning, and we'll see you in the cafe.
Put that hunger in your heart. Put that fire in your soul.